Hello, everyone. My name is Winston Adkins, and I'll be the moderator for this portion of the forum. I'm the preservation officer for the Duke University Libraries and one of eight members of CRL's certification advisory panel. Our panel, chaired by Martha Brogan of the University of Pennsylvania, represents the membership's interest in CRL's initiative to review the trustworthiness of digital repositories. So far, we've looked at Portico, HathiTrust, the National Library of New Zealand, and Chronopolis. It's been an interesting initiative for me. CRL has a long experience with preservation and library content, including primary source materials, and they're applying it to digital content organizations. For those of you who are less familiar with CRL's work with digital preservation, I'd encourage you to look under the Archives and Preservation tab on their website. You'll see that CRL has been building resources and tools to give us information about the digital preservation efforts of publishers, digital repositories, and the other services we count on to supply and preserve information. We all invest heavily in these resources, and we're faced with deciding how best to store them and ensure their usefulness and usability over the long run. We can choose to host our content locally, collaboratively, or turn it over to a centralized service, and we can have it managed through a central service or as part of a cooperatively run organization. As we face these decisions, we often wish we could look under the hood to understand the services better. CRL's initiative to certify digital repositories gives us a library-oriented profile of repositories' strengths and weaknesses and allows us to assess that profile against our needs. For this session, we have asked Eileen Fenton and Amy Kirchhoff from Portico and John Wilkin of HathiTrust to discuss their organization's preservation efforts. Each will give us a short overview of their repository and its services, and we'll follow each presentation with a Q&A period. By the way, you can submit questions to the presenters at any time during the presentation. To submit your question, please use the chat function in the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. So let's begin our discussion. Eileen Fenton and Amy Kirchhoff will discuss Portico for us. Eileen is Ithaca's Executive Vice President for Content and Technology Services and Portico's Managing Director. She's led Portico since its founding in 2002. And previously, Eileen was Director of Production for JSTOR, another service of Ithaca, and oversaw the addition of more than 13 million pages to their archival collections. Amy Kirchhoff has been Archive Service Product Manager for Portico since 2006. She's responsible for creation and execution of archival policy, and she oversees operation and development of the Portico website. Prior to her work at Portico, Amy was Director of Technology for JSTOR and served as a member of the Shared Software Development Group at Ithaca. Portico itself began as a digital repository for e-journals, but they've since branched into preservation of e-books and digitized historical collections, or d-collections. Today, we'll be talking with Eileen and Amy specifically about their D collections. These are primary source collections and contain content from Adam Matthews Digital and from Gale. Should a triggering event occur, Portico will only make these materials available to Portico member libraries that had a subscription to the collection with the publisher. Eileen?
Thanks, Winston. I appreciate the chance to be here today. So thanks to Bernie for inviting me. And Amy and I are glad to be able to share with the CRL members a bit about Portico's work preserving primary source materials, or D collections as we call them. What I'll do is offer some brief overview of Portico, just to give folks who might not be familiar just a brief sense of Portico's work. But we'll spend the most of my time talking about D collections and how we've approached that. I'll be offering those comments, but during Q&A, depending on the question, I'll answer or I'll ask Amy to speak up. Amy was especially involved in the CRL audit of Portico, so any questions, especially in that area, Amy's a great resource. With that, I'll just jump in to note that Portico is at the moment the largest community supported archive in the world, and when I say in the world, I'm like CRL. Portico is very much an international organization with libraries and publishers participating from around the world. We work with libraries and publishers and funders to make sure that a range of digital content is well preserved and available into the future when it needs to be. If we flip to the next slide, we'll get just a quick snapshot of what that participation looks like on the publishing side. For more than 2,000 societies, we have agreements with 120-plus publishers that have committed the list of content that you see there. What this means is there's a little over 12,000 e-journals that have been committed to be preserved in the Portico archive, a little bit over 70,000 e-books, and a much smaller number, although you'll see in a moment, large in size, 39 collections from the two publishers that Winston named have also been committed to the Portico archive. If you look at the next slide, I think it's interesting just to see how those title counts compare to quantity of files. Total in the archive, there's in the range of 300 million files being preserved in the archive. And I think it's just interesting to see how journals, books, and decollections are represented in the number of files that are preserved in the archive. Obviously, lots of those files are related to e-journals, but lots of files are also related to primary source materials or decollections. Just to give you a sense of how that content came into the archive over time, if we look to the next slide, there's just a couple of highlights here in Portico's development. Started as a pilot project, actually, within JSTOR, and then began ingesting content into the Portico archive in 2006, which I'll note is also when we did a test audit with CRL under the auspices of a Mellon grant as CRL was working to develop audit methodologies. We began to offer some access to some of the preserved content in the Portico archive as early as 2007, which I'll confess was much earlier than we had anticipated. Pulled ebooks into the archive in 2009, specifically because we were hearing from publishers and libraries that that was sort of the next range of content that was of concern. Also in 2009, responded to the first need to provide some post-cancellation access to a library that had canceled the title but needed ongoing access, and we provided that at that publisher's request to the library. Also in 2009, we started a formal audit with CRL, which in 2010, I'm happy to say, yielded a certification, which was the same year that we began ingesting digitized collections into the archive. If you see in the next slide, as Portico began, it really was a sort of unified preservation service. So if a library was participating in Portico, they were helping to support preservation of e-journals, preservation of e-books. But then as more materials began to be preserved in the Portico archive, as we've tried to illustrate on the next slide, it became clear to us that we needed to be able to offer more choice to libraries. For some libraries, e-journal preservation may in fact be the limit of their preservation need at this time. And so we've restructured participation in the Portico archive beginning this year so that if a library wants to participate only in e-journal preservation, they can do so, or they can participate only in e-book preservation or both. And decollections have also recently come into the archive. Starting with the next slide, I'd like to walk through how it is that Portico has approached the preservation of decollections. And starting with probably what is the most pressing area of interest is how is the cause of the preservation of that kind of material covered? Because it's covered a little bit differently than some other genres that are being preserved in Portico. The publishers cover the full cost of preserving their primary source, their digitized primary source materials in the Portico archive. So the publishers pay a fee that helps us provide that services. Libraries do not pay a fee to participate in that part of Portico's preservation service. If you you look on the next slide, you can see that the materials, the decollection materials that are being held in Portico become available under very specific conditions and very specific institutions. They become available when a publisher might cease to offer that material or offer part of that material, or those materials are no longer available from any other source. Available only to those libraries that were initial purchasers or subscribers to those digitized collections. The digitized collections seem to be a bit more niche. Some libraries, they're very, very important to them. Others, maybe not so much, whereas journals tend to be more broadly taken up. And we've tried to acknowledge that with this different approach here. The notion of post-cancellation access is also available in that a publisher can name Portico as a provider of post-cancellation access for decollections as well. And I think it's always important to remind ourselves of why preservation of this material matters. Like, as we're doing the preservation work, what is the goal there? And the next slide, we've tried to just illustrate what that goal is. I think it's important to keep in mind that when we talk about preservation, we're really talking about an ongoing, proactive activity that is all about having the management, the policies, the activities necessary that pursue the four goals that are called out on the slide that you see. Digital preservation is really all about ensuring that the materials that libraries have purchased or licensed, often at great expense, remain usable, the intellectual content is there, that remain authentic. You know that the material is as it was originally published, the provenance is known, the material can be discovered, it's not just lost on some server somewhere, but you can actually find and locate that material, and finally it can be made accessible at the right moment in time and under the right conditions. Those are really the goals of preservation, and on the following slide, we've just tried to call out some of the activities that ongoing preservation management requires. Replicating the archive so there are multiple copies, having audits like the audit done by CRL, repairing or replacing content if it gets corrupted or equipment if it fails, and then ongoing activities around validating files or updating files if a new version is produced, making sure we keep both the old version and the new version, and making sure that there are active preservation plans in place to be sure that we're staying current with best practices. On the following slide, I thought it might be helpful to also provide some information about specific content that has been committed to the Portico archive. These are the listing of specific primary source collections offered by Gale and Adam Matthew that have been committed to be preserved in the Portico archive. Our work to bring that content into the archive is underway and ongoing. And on the following slide, you can see the listing of collections that are already in the Portico archive, and just helpful to see the number of books or issues that represents for each of those products. That's just a quick overview of Portico's work preserving decollections. I'm happy to answer questions. Amy and I are happy to answer questions as you might have them.
Thank you, Eileen. Now we'll open the discussion to questions from the floor. Remember, please submit your questions via the chat feature on your screen. Who is on your wish list of publishers who haven't yet agreed to deposit content into Portico?
Well, our wish list is really driven by what we hear from libraries is on their wish list. So whether it's a journal or a book or a decollection, our goal really is to make sure that we're focusing the resources we have on preserving the content that is most important from the library perspective. Some publishers that have been mentioned by libraries, I suppose the publisher that has probably popped up in the decollection space most frequently in our conversations with libraries is ProQuest. and we've had some conversations with them, but those are ongoing. Sometimes it's not so much a publisher that a library might mention, but some additional content from Cengage or Adam Matthew, so it comes to us in a couple of different formats.
Okay. Well, thanks. Another question is, when Portico was just journal content, I understood that all articles were reformatted, as we used to say, to a singular schema. Are ebooks and d-collections similarly normalized or otherwise converted?
That's a great question, actually, because what we have determined as we've had an opportunity to look at journals, look at books, and look at d-collections is migration, as we've called it, or normalizing to an archival format isn't always required. And in the case of d-collections, that's an example where reformatting at this time is not required. So we're able to bring that material into the archive in the format in which we've received it, and the format comes to us along with a lot of documentation around that format. And so additional reformatting is not needed at this time. Part of our preservation planning around those materials is to think about when will that be needed, what are the sorts of milestones or thresholds that will be hit to signal to us that some additional reformatting might be needed. Amy, is there any additional input on that question that you want to offer?
Sure. The D-collections are very, very different from e-journals because we get so much content in one format. So one of the drivers behind e-journals and the early transformation of the content is sort of the staggering thought that in 10 years you might have to try and do something with e-journal content that you got 10 years previously that you hadn't looked at, which would be really, really quite challenging given the variety of ways publishers publish e-journals. Whereas with e-collections, that is just not so. There is so much content, and it tends to be beautifully clean. It's also not usually very complex. It's just much, much less necessary. So I think this does highlight how different content types and different publishers have different ways of meeting the same preservation needs. I will say that we do still do a transformation of the packaging. So all content that goes into the Portico archive has is moved from whatever the publisher's original packaging is into the Portico content model, and has the same set of types of preservation metadata attached to it in terms of events and technical metadata that's captured. And that is true no matter what content type is we're discussing.
Okay, well, thank you. What would happen to the D-collections if Portico were to fail?
That's a great question. I think it's healthy for any archive to contemplate its demise and what that might mean. The way that we think about that question is that it's important for an archive to have the right to preserve the content, but also have the right to pass that obligation and right along to some other enterprise. So when we sign an agreement with a publisher as part of that agreement, and our publisher agreements, by the way, are posted on the Portico website, part of our agreement is to secure from the publisher the right to transfer our preservation rights and obligations to another not-for-profit organization. So in the case of Portico's demise, we wouldn't have to scurry around and get rights to do that. We already have from the content providers the right to pass that obligation along to some other party.
Okay. Thank you. When folks registered, they filled out a survey, and here it is, and folks were very interested in the interface and the types of material you were going to be collecting. Can you talk a bit about plans for expanding the D-collections model to include digital collections created by libraries and offered by libraries from their own platforms, not just commercial publishers?
Yes, I'd love to. And in fact, we did a study with about 16 library participants a year or so ago, and did some investigations in this area, in part with some funding from NEH and IMLS, to look at the range of content being digitized by libraries and what would it mean for us to begin to preserve some of that material in the Portico archives. And we found some really interesting findings from that effort. I suppose not surprisingly, one of the findings was that the number of formats, metadata structures, and approaches that libraries have taken to digitizing their materials varies widely. It's a really wonderful and diverse range of formats, metadata structures, resolutions, image resolutions, and so on, which raises some real complexities, frankly, around preservation and has an impact on potential cost for preserving that material. So as we've thought about that, we've tried to think about, are there ways in which we could have, I don't know, different tiers of preservation, I suppose, that might allow for sort of shorter-term protection versus longer-term protection that might give a library options, and options at different cost levels. We've actually been doing some brainstorming with the B Press, Digital Commons about taking in some of the content that they're holding on libraries' behalf, and is that a way to move some materials into the Portico archive? But we tried to think about that in ways that would give libraries choice about what level of preservation they want to bring to bear. It's not something we've been able to sort of move beyond the study phase to a pilot phase yet. But we're very interested in thinking with libraries about what that need might look like, and thinking with other preservation repositories like HathiTrust about how we can work together to meet some of those needs. There's a lot of content out there, and we want to be careful about duplication of effort.
Okay. Well, thank you. May I ask quickly who owns the content in the Portico repository?
The original content creator owns the content. The preservation-related metadata that Portico has created is owned by Portico, but the content owner, you know, owns the content.
Great, thank you. And the next question is, are there formats you do not accept, say, with the D collections?
No, there are not.
Great. Oh, that, by the way, that question was from David Lowe.
Okay. Thank you, David. It's a great question. If I maybe can offer a slightly broader answer than just, no, we do not. We don't actually impose any submission requirements on a publisher wanting, or a content provider wanting to preserve content in the Portico archive. We don't say, yes, we'll preserve your stuff, but you got to submit it in the following way, or it has to be in the following formats. Sometimes there's a little bit of a misperception that we have that. I don't know quite where that comes from. Sometimes publishers will ask us, is there a way you prefer to get it, or a format that you prefer, and we're certainly happy to offer preferences, but there aren't requirements. Some of the more exotic formats, we may be limited in the level of preservation we can provide. My favorite example here is sometimes a journal article might have a unique executable file attached to it in a new programming language that the author has invented and written an article about. Our ability to preserve the full functionality of that new programming language might be limited, but there aren't any format restrictions in terms of what can be submitted.
Okay. Well, has Portico made arrangements for using the publisher's interfaces or something similar to give our users search capabilities similar to what the publisher had provided?
A good question, because it gets right at that aspect of the goal of digital preservation being about usability. And we don't make an effort to preserve the publisher's current interface form. Our focus really is preserving the underlying content. And part of what drives that approach is that, you know, Portico is an archive that holds material against the day, against the worry that at some point in the future it may not be available. We don't know when that point might be in the future, nor do we know what the interface requirements, preferences, preferred browsers, etc., might be for the user community at that time. So we make the investment of the participants' resources in preservation of the content with a minimal interface around it for auditing purposes. A library can come and look in the archive at any time to understand what is being preserved there. But our focus isn't so much on all the bells and whistles. You can certainly search the archive and view the content that's there. But we're not necessarily trying to preserve exactly the publisher's temporal interface of the moment.
Okay, thank you. Tony Harava at the University of Ottawa asked, does Portico accept material in different languages and character sets?
We do accept materials in different languages. There are already materials, non-English materials, in the Portico archive, and some materials that are not necessarily in the English alphabet. There's quite a bit of Russian, for instance, in the archive as well.
Well, thank you. And when do you decide to migrate to a new format?
Ah, good question. I'll ask Amy to chime in here as well. But monitoring the currency of a format is part of the ongoing work of Portico. Typically, migration is oriented toward when we might need to make a change in order to successfully render it or move it out of a publisher's proprietary format structure. But I'll ask Amy to speak to this as well.
It's a really good question. We were actually literally just talking about this last week when we were sort of sketching out what a preservation research agenda might look like through the end of the year. And you know, the catch is that we monitor the file format community and we monitor the preservation community both really closely. And it's an area where we feel partnerships are really, really important. So, you know, one of our big factors that we're looking for is when there are strong signs that existing hardware is not going to support a format. As Eileen mentioned, we have sort of different preservation policies for different formats. So for at this exact moment in time, the concern we would have for a PDF that was becoming less stable is much higher than the concern we would have for a Word document, mostly just because of sort of massive amounts of quantity having to do with, you know, that's where the priority needs to be at the moment, given the look of the entire archive. So it's an area where we're constantly doing research, we're constantly paying really close attention to conversations that are happening within both the file format community and the preservation community. We do have an Ithaca-wide working group we call our Preservation Management Working Group, which pulls in people from all of the different Ithaca services. So we've got an SNR staff representative, we've got some content management, we've got some content development, publisher relations representation there, where we make sure we do things like address research agenda and look at developing preservation policies for different services. And that is another point of entry we have into many of the community efforts that are happening in this regard.
Great. Let's see. May I ask you one last question as we wind up? How large can the Portico archive become?
How large can the Portico archive become? I would say I'm not. There are many vectors on which you can answer that. Quantities of content or types of content, or I would say there isn't any obvious limit. I would say the limit is really driven by what the community need is. To the degree that a service like Portico focused on preservation can step in and meet library and scholarly publishers' needs. There's some boundary on that, but what that looks like, I'm not quite sure. I don't think I can see it from where we are today, given the vast quantities of electronic content that is really important to the scholarly record. I'm sure there must be a boundary, but it's hard to see from where we are right now.
Okay. Well, thank you, Eileen and Amy. That was great. And next, John Wilkin will discuss HathiTrust. John Wilkin is the Associate University Librarian for Library Information Technology for the University of Michigan Library and also the Executive Director of HathiTrust. Prior to becoming the AUL for Library Information Technology, John served as the head of the Digital Library Production Service at the University of Michigan, a position he held from its inception in 1996. HathiTrust was founded in 2008 to serve as a digital repository aimed at housing the published record. Initially, it included 13 universities of the Committee on Institutional Cooperation, the University of California system, and the University of Virginia. Today, HathiTrust includes more than 50 libraries, and currently the content is overwhelmingly from the partners Google, Internet Archive, and Microsoft digitization projects, and consequently may be under copyright or in the public domain. HathiTrust is planning to expand its content, tools, and services for the use of the library community. John?
Thank you, Winston, and thanks all of you for having me here. I want to talk today not about our digital preservation strategy and not about our cost models, nor about governance, but about the collection that is HathiTrust, about what we think of as the value of the collective collection. So if we could go to the next slide, what I'm going to do is start with a brief statement about what HathiTrust is and what we're trying to accomplish. First of all, I should say it's a part